Jacobine Hine, Adam here. Hello and welcome to online virtual Burning Man. Today's topic, microdosing 2020, community, coaching, and personalized protocols. I've got some amazing people here with me today. They're both the founders of the Microdosing Institute out of the Netherlands. Their Dutch Facebook community has more than 35 active members discussing microdosing. Their microdosing coaching team has coached more than 200 people in one-on-one settings. Four times a year, this group organizes workshops with more than 40 people at a time. They're set on education, events, and facilitating one-on-one and group coaching and counseling. Most importantly, they were the first microdosing platform online in all of Europe. And most importantly for me, these are the creators and the inventors of the day on, day off protocol. So thank you for coming here today, Jacobine and Hein. We're so happy to have you.
Thank you, Adam.
Thank you.
Awesome. Do you want to share a little bit more here at the beginning about the Microdosing Institute and the work that you guys have been doing?
Yes, of course. Well, my name is Hein, as you mentioned. At first we wanted to start with the microdosing.nl website and platform, and we wanted to build bridges between the microdosers and the people who research microdosing. So we built a bridge to all the researchers in the world who do, we assist them on their research, like Jim Fadiman and Vince Polito from Australia, Kim Kuipers from the University of Maastricht. So all those guys have been doing great work, and we assist them where we can with our experience on microdosing. So that was the first goal we had with our platform, actually. And of course, because connecting with each other, finding the others, it's very important. We want to build a community. So the online, but also in meetups and events and seminars.
Yes, because microdosing can be done legally in the Netherlands, we have legal magic truffles available. So this was why in 2016, actually, we realized, hey, there is information about microdosing online, but it's all in English. It comes from the United States. And here in the Netherlands, we can actually have a legal microdosing experience, and people should be able to talk about it between themselves. And so we started really like this in the Netherlands with a Dutch website. But now we are moving more internationally, and we are now the Microdosing Institute, and offering coaching and consultancy, and still focusing very much on community and kind of like the wisdom of the crowds, and bringing research results and experiences from everybody back to the community. And I think it was through James Fadiman that we were introduced to you as someone who has a very similar mission and is doing a very similar job down there in the United States, in California. So maybe you want to speak a little bit more about how this got started for you.
Awesome, thank you. I met Dr. Fadiman after a speech at SEPTR in Salt Lake City on psychedelic science and psychedelic therapies. I told him a little bit about the work that I was doing, coaching and working with clients regarding microdosing. And he connected me with Hein and Jacobine in Europe, who have been doing it for years legally and reliably. From there, we've formed a partnership where I'll be able to take my company, Flow State Micro, safely and legally into Europe, and be able to provide microdosing kits to the Netherlands and European Union. More importantly, Dr. Fadiman connected us because these guys have such great data from years of doing this and their online group. And I think most importantly, we need to hop right into the education here, because I think education is key, and you guys have been doing this for some time. Can you just give our viewers here a basic quick little run over, a little 101, Jacobine, what is microdosing?
Yeah, so what is microdosing? We, of course, lots of people who want to start microdosing, you know, they've already like informed themselves, listened to podcasts, have been researching this topic. So you come back to like, okay, it's between 1/20th and 1/10th of a recreational dose of a classic psychedelic. For most people, that is a psilocybin, mushroom or truffle. or it is LSD, but it can be done with all these other psychedelics too. But we don't, in this talk, we feel like this has already been covered in so many other resources on the internet. And this is also for us, for our platform, our mission was really, we discovered it's such a personalized journey. And that is something that is not often, we don't think it cannot be stressed enough that this is personal. And that, so we want to focus actually on what microdosing is not. And so that it is not some kind of medicine, that is not some kind of magic bullet that takes you, that changes you, and immediately you can be, you know, super proactive, full of creativity, full of flow, and that all happens automatically, and your anxiety is gone and your depression is gone. But this is very often still how it is displayed in the media. These are like the experience that people report and that are extracted and then put back into, through the media, coming back out to us. And that's what people start to believe then very easily. But we want to focus, in our work, we focus a lot on what is microdosing, what it is not. And we see it more as a, like a tool, an instrument, such as, for example, an electric bike. So it can give you that extra power. It can give you this extra help, and things seem much more effortless and easily, but you have to do the pedaling. So it is you who still is key in this whole process. Yeah. And without you knowing where you're pedaling and without you doing the actual work, you won't get as much result as you would probably believe from the media, from the stories. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Hein, what would you have to say about dosage? We were talking briefly the other day. You guys were mentioning, you're noticing that one of the biggest mistakes people make when they start microdosing is they're taking too strong of a dose. Can you talk a little bit about dosage?
Yeah, well, at first it was 1/10 of a recreational dose. Then you can discuss, of course, what is a recreational dose. At first, 20 micrograms of LSD was also a microdose. But yeah, after 1 year or something, you start noticing that it was way too much for most people. So they read it and they took it and they thought, yeah, I can function in daily routine with that. So yeah, now you see that people starting to lower their dose. And for dried mushrooms, it's about 0.1 to 0.3 grams dried mushroom, depending on the strength of the mushroom, of course. And with LSD, it's like 0.4 micrograms still, maybe 12 micrograms at most that people take for microdose. But the danger about that is that now the commercial shops and entrepreneurs now are making these products, and the danger is that they make a product one size fits all, and that's where what we discovered is that's not the case. It's personal for everybody. It depends on their metabolism and their own sensitive ways of how they, what they do in their lives, the creative work or just office work. It all depends on the person itself. So that's why we start noticing that with coaching and guiding that we make a personalized protocol for them, and then we work with that. And we also emphasize what Jacobino already told, is that you are the main character in this story. The microdose works with you and not for you. And if you get that, that is an aid and a tool for you, then you get much more out of it. And so.
That's great. Yeah, I've noticed the same thing, that one microdose amount isn't gonna work the same from one person to the next. Jacobine, did you have anything else to say about dosage?
So we see that on average it takes people between 1 and 2 weeks to really find their own personalized dose, to really calibrate. And I think that's why it's so useful to do a regular check-in with a person who's just starting to microdose, because it's very typical that they start with whatever is the average dose, and they say, oh yeah, it actually gives me, I feel great and I'm super productive and all of that. But I also have a bit of a headache, for example. And I actually also at the end of the day, I feel really, really tired. And that could be a sign that it's just like too much that's going through their system that day of microdosing. But I think in the past, like a couple of years ago, this was what people believed was microdosing, that this is how it's supposed to be. You're really going into that active mode. You can get all your things done, no more procrastination. But as a consequence, at the end of the day, you feel a bit tired or you feel a bit maybe a bit worn out. So we discovered really over the last years that people can actually go down with their dose and have it really fully integrated into their normal daily life and be comfortable with it. And so that's how we ended up with those lower doses. And that's why we still believe that those products that you now see on the market that sort of prescribe almost as if it were a prescription drug, that it's something to be a bit careful about because that dose might be too high for you. That's why we think it's really important that you don't just, you know, straight on go buy that product with sometimes beautiful branding and lots of explanations and lots of other working materials, which is great that it's being provided, but it is still a personalized journey. Yeah. And I think it's very simple. Just we all have a different amount of receptors in our brain. So your weight, for example, your body weight or your body mass doesn't really matter. You can be a really big person and still be on a fairly relatively low microdose because it's about the amount of receptors.
That's great. And let's be clear here. A microdose is supposed to be sub-perceptual. So that's meaning that you're not supposed to feel high, you're not supposed to really be noticing it as well. So you guys are obviously noticing that people need to lower their dose sometimes to get more benefits from their normal dose.
Yeah,
it's totally normal that people want to feel something. If you want to feel an effect or something, and the best way to take a microdose is that you take it and then during the day you forget that you took it. And if you take a too high dose, then you are constantly aware of the effect. And that kind of it's kind of like a dog chasing its own tail. Then you are focusing too much on the effect and you start to lose the awareness and the pointers which were microdosing points to what you have to learn or what you have to be more aware of or something. So
let's take and transition into protocols, because I think it's really important, and I think the real key of the talk that we're wanting to get across today is how important that individualized protocol is. So do one of you want to start talking about kind of the three most popular protocols out there, which are the Stamets, the Fadiman, and then your own Microdosing Institute protocol?
Yeah, well, of course, everybody knows James Fadiman, the founder of microdosing. He developed the protocol, the Fadiman protocol, and that's every third day you take a microdose for like a month. And it's really developed for research, doing self-research and reporting to Dr. James Fadiman in this case. So that's the main protocol. And it's a very good way if people are starting to microdose for personal growth, it's a very good protocol to start with, actually. But we noticed that a lot of people because every day is different, it's on a Monday, and then on a Thursday, and then on a Tuesday, and that sort of thing. So for some people on their work, it's more better to take 2 days in 1 week. They choose two, like on Wednesday and Sunday or something. So it's more integrated in their social life. So that's also more personalized. Then we have the Paul Stamets protocol. Some people say it's 5 days on, 2 days off, and another lecture he mentioned that it's 4 days on, 3 days off. Yeah, that's specially developed for the stacking formula, which he had developed with lion's mane and niacin and psilocybin. And I think
why does he believe, could you maybe just mention why does he believe you need to do it this way? So all those days in a row, what would be the actual added benefit?
Well, there are only two lectures where he talks about it, and one on Joe Rogan, and he doesn't really, I don't know for sure it's stacking, so it has to get in your system like a baseline, like paracetamol if you're or another medicine, that if you take it for over a period of time, then it's starting to this reconnect and rebalance your system. Mm-hmm. But then again, it's also discussable about the tolerance. Psychedelic have a high tolerance, so some people notice that that if you take your psilocybin too high on the stacking formula, then you start noticing the tolerance.
Because I remember, I think it was actually in a couple of talks where James Vaderman mentioned he was asked to reflect on Stamets protocol, and he said, I believe there is not really a difference because of the tolerance. So you keep taking something, but it is already in your system. So it is already doing its work. And it might be that it's just like, he didn't say explicitly for commercial reasons, but he say it could be more cost effective if you microdose less, because it might not, it's not proven that you actually need those extra days. But I'd really be curious of like a larger community of people. Yeah, I'd really be curious to see the results of a larger group of people.
We need Paul Stamets to come out and speak more about his stack and his protocol, because we a lot of people look up to him, and we could use some more information on that. With Dr. Fadiman's protocol, his idea was you take it on the first day, but the second day you're still getting benefits from it, because even sub-threshold doses of psychedelics have a 48-hour effect. So I have to wonder if part of Stamets's protocol is that it's built up in your system over those 4 days, and then those 3 days off, you're still getting somewhat of that 48-hour effect. I know for me that if an individual is dealing with antidepressants or medications, that sometimes in the weaning process of the first few months, they can't really afford 3 days off at a time. So that's why I think it's really important to get across that, whether it's the Fadiman protocol or the Stamets protocol or the Microdose Institute protocol, a protocol's really got to be individualized to that person, what's going on in their life, what their intention is, what they're looking to get out of it. Before we move on from protocols, will you guys just talk about the protocol you came up with, Jacobine, and why you came up with that protocol or what you were seeing?
When we've been coaching people and offering this one-on-one guidance, we've always started off recommending the Fadiman protocol, because we say, you know, it's very important that you get to know this substance, that you get to know what microdosing is actually doing for you, you monitor the effects also on the days that you're not microdosing. So this microdosing day, transition day, normal day, so the 3 days on, so the once per 3 day microdose, that's how we started off recommending this to people, and see how that works out for you. So just as Fadiman sort of said, and do that for at least a month or 2 months, and then find out what's best for you. And that's where we noticed that for many people, especially the ones dealing with depression, that they could not really afford that third day off of having no effects. They would rather take another microdose on that third day. So this is how the once every 2 days protocol came into existence. And for some people, this was really a lifesaver. This really made a difference, like between having, relatively little benefit to having a real benefit, and so much more benefit than taking any antidepressant or and for also for ADHD, this is people dealing with ADHD or ADD, this is also a protocol that seems to serve them better. So we were for a long time, this protocol didn't have a name. But at some point, people started pointing towards us as let's give this protocol a name, and it came into and then I think James Fetterman even mentioned it later on with this name that it's originating from us. So we're slowly but steadily taking that credit now. Yeah. That's great. Anything you want to add, Hein, on this?
I just know the people who we guided, and they just on the third day at first they just waited to end that third day was ending because they were waited to take a microdose again. And yeah, it's not a case that you are started craving for a microdose, so you just have to go with that flow. And yeah, so the every other day protocol was more in the flow of the person itself. But yeah, we start noting that it's not for everybody. Some people, they just like the Fetterman protocol more. Or yeah, what we also see is the more intuitive protocol. So we also always emphasize that follow your intuition on that. If you feel like you don't want to do it, just don't. And if you feel like experimenting with your sweet spot, for instance, we always say you have to have a sweet spot, but even that is variable in different situations and different days of your life. If you go and walk in nature, some people take a little bit of a higher dose, and if you go to work, to a meeting or something, then people vary with that also. So the intuitive protocol is also a very interesting one, and people use that a lot. But for medical purposes, the every other day protocol, or the Microdosing Institute protocol, whatever you mean it, call it, that can be a lifesaver, what you said, or what you talk about with your clients, Adam. That's also that's the weaning off the medicine, what you said.
I know for me that we've had a lot of success with people weaning off of a lot of prescription medications. We're talking about everything from Percocet, which is an opiate, I believe, to Adderall, to all kinds of antidepressants. And the weaning of pharmaceuticals is a serious, serious thing. People need to be notifying their doctors. They need to be getting a proper weaning protocol, a safe protocol from their doctors. And then these type of people are going to need to microdose more often. You know, they're not going to be able to afford 2, 3, 4 days off a week when their body is adjusting from, you know, years of these other substances. So again, specifically with the SSRIs, the tapering takes a while. You know, it can take 2 to 3 months sometimes, lowering the doses. But the thing that we're seeing is that something's happening with the microdosing of the mushrooms where it's helping people with withdrawal. It's helping people with the weaning. It's somewhat helping them get out of that default mode network and stay in more of a positive place. So definitely seeing some benefits from that as well.
It's like James Fetterman mentioned, James Fetterman mentioned it also, like if you take antidepressant, then your mood starting to temper, but if you microdose with it, then you're also starting to feeling better. And although the SSRI is damping the effect of the microdose, maybe, but it still has a positive effect. It's just making it your world a little bit brighter and seeing like a light in the end of the tunnel. And
It's very motivating, right?
Yeah,
it's very motivating. And especially now, 2020, you know, there's fires all over California. We've been locked inside for a week with the air quality being so bad. This pandemic is going on. You know, now more than ever, people are reaching out to psychedelics for guidance, for help. You guys were mentioning earlier, you've seen, you know, coaching clientele go up. Sales double on the Truffle site. People are hungry for this. They need this. You know, what can you say to somebody who is interested in using microdosing to maybe get off some pharmaceuticals or other substances? Would your advice be?
Actually, I was having the same question in my mind. You were just talking about the weaning off and how microdosing can help. But I was actually going to ask maybe all of us as a general question. So if somebody is on antidepressants for a long time and doesn't like the side effects, doesn't like who he or she is at that moment and know there must be another way. So would the recommendation be to, in an ideal scenario, to first wean off and then start microdosing? Or would you say, no, it's also possible to wean off using microdosing as an aid? Or what are the differences between those two options? Or are there even more options?
Yeah, again, I'm not a medical doctor. I would not wean off of any doctor prescribed pharmaceutical drug without serious support, especially with the antidepressants and the SSRIs. You need a community of support. You need a therapist or a coach, somebody you're talking to, you're doing pre and post integration with. I know for myself, if I'm working with somebody weaning off of SSRIs, that they need to add exercise to their life, they need to look at their diet. You know, so we need to change a lot of different things in the person's life that benefits them later down the line on the days off where they're not taking the microdose. But with people who've been on SSRIs and their hormones have been messed with for so many years, it's very, very dangerous to try and go cold turkey off of your antidepressants. So please, please do not do that. What we're saying is it's possible to get off of antidepressants with the proper community, proper coaching, proper reliable supplements in the right dose. And then what's happening is the mushrooms are somewhat counteracting those bad feelings and what you're feeling in the antidepressants. And over time, when you're adding exercise and you're adding positive things to your life, you're slowly taking less and less of the antidepressants. And your body is recovering with the help of the mushrooms. I do really believe the microdosing of the truffles or the mushrooms, again, they're adaptogens. They're adapting to what your body needs. Yeah. So please do not wean off of any pharmaceuticals without a full community of support behind you.
Yeah. It really rebalancing the natural healing system in that case, yeah. Yeah, we are still struggling when we get emails or questions about what do you recommend, what should I do with that? Because we are also not doctors, and that's why we set up now a coaching or therapist network with people who are experts in that field, the regular sector of an alternative sector in Holland, like trauma therapists and psychotherapists, who have a lot of experience with psychedelics in general. So now we are setting up and we are working with those therapists. So if we get like clients who have this kind of questions and they still have, because we don't give them the microdose, they do it themselves. They are responsible for their own actions and their own microdosing journey, but we guide them through them and we work together with the therapist. So that's our structure on how we work with people who are having issues with depression and tapering off antidepressants.
Yeah, we found we found also that microdosing is not the solution for every mental challenge that people might have. So, and this is something that this really surprised us over the past years, that we get such a wide variety of requests with people such different backgrounds and journeys already in their life. And sometimes we can just see, or we have a talk with them and we see, oh, but there's a lot of trauma in your system, and microdosing is not gonna fully help. It's not enough, and especially if you don't have any other proper support, that is not going to clear the trauma out of your system. Or if you're in an intense grief, that's a process. Microdosing is not going to help with that particular process. And then there's a variety of other more specific problems that we also don't know that there's a history of, that microdosing could really help. So this is where we always loop in other therapists in the conversation that are familiar with the work with psychedelics and have microdosed for themselves, so they can see like where, up until where can we work, and where does this other field of expertise start, and yeah, very often that is where those people start with actually doing that work and really like stabilizing themselves and finding their kind of finding their own center again. And then additionally or later for, you know, further optimizing their journey and like moving forward and keep making progress, then microdosing might be at some point really relevant and beneficial for them. So
What you see if they do it on their own, people who have depression, what you mostly see is that in the 2 months they microdose, they feel an uplift and they feel better. But and microdosing shows you the points you need to work on. But yeah, you have to work on it yourself. The microdosing is not going to do that for you. So if they don't do that and if they lack the tools of self-education or self-reflection, then they fall back into their depression again. So yeah, and that's where coaching or guiding can help them out, getting the most out of their microdosing experience and really using it as a tool.
So what you're saying is microdosing isn't this magic pill where you just take it and all your problems are solved. You're saying that like there's more work that's involved.
Well, it would have been great if that was the case, but it's not our opinion at all. I like to say is that the microdosing, they tell their experience, they tell the stories to the media, and the media, they make like the big headlines like microdosing makes you more creative, or they just gave a lot of interviews and they turn around your words and make it into a nice story. So the media make the claims actually. So, and that's why everybody is like, in 2015, the Rolling Stone wrote about microdosing at first, it was also like a big, they pump it up like a media hype. The researchers, they have to make the claims and not the media. So people are...
I get it. I get what you're saying. We have to be careful with the claims. And at the same time, I know for myself, my personal journey that I helped to basically cure, in my opinion, a lifetime of addiction to misery and treatment-resistant depression, what you would call that. So I know that this microdosing, specifically in my opinion, of mushrooms has the ability to really help people find happiness, heal their trauma, and really optimize and make their life better. What I will say is the microdosing was part and parcel of the whole thing. The microdosing, more than anything, led me to eating healthier, to exercising more. I really feel like, you know, and again, I'm not a scientist, but it blocks the default mode network and is getting you in areas of your brain where you are more creative, you're more positive, you're more energized. So I do believe really is the future of medicine. But again, it's not just you're taking the substance and it's healing you. You know, I think Alan Watts has a great quote where he talks about the scientist doesn't keep his eye on the microscope all day. You know, he sees what he needs to see and then he comes back and he lives his life. And I think that's what microdosing or even large dose psychedelics for us does, is it shines the light in the areas that we need to do the work. Yeah. But if we don't do the work, it's not like it's going to do the work for you.
No. Yeah.
That's for sure.
Yeah, exactly. I feel also this, this image came up for me actually today of the, I think, you know, I grew up in the 80s and 90s, and there were lots of sports commercials like Nike and Adidas, and they put out those commercials like, you know, put on these shoes and you're going to be this amazing runner who wins the Olympics. And the focus is really so, and also for microdosing, it seems like people jump in, they focus very much on the tool, so on the substance. Which substance do I need to take and how much? And then tell me, and I will do that. And then I go straight up there where I want to go. And what I came to realize for me, this is actually what got me interested in psychedelics in the first place. It reveals so much of yourself. It reveals like, hey, how do I think? How do I react? What is my normal behavior? And what is the actual behavior I would like to have from myself? What better habits are there that I would like to have, or how do I like to feel? instead of, you know, just going about your day and just thinking about all your duties or what others are expecting from you, but actually, no, what are my needs and what are my feelings, and can I just let them be and grow myself into a stronger person from there? And I think that sort of core, understanding is really where you can make microdosing into maybe that little magic bullet, but then it's actually you being that part. You just need something maybe to light that fire. And
that's the beauty of it. Some people just need a spark. They just need that little kick in their ass to get them going. And that's really what it could be. I know for me, I moved into this space out of cannabis specifically because it helped me to really cure and treat my lifetime of depression. Hein, I know your personal story goes along the lines of you lost a dear friend to cluster headaches. He took his own life because he couldn't stand the pain. And then I believe years later, you saw research that microdosing actually helps to relieve cluster headaches. So do you want to talk about that or about cluster headaches?
Well, the main reason why I wanted to start a community or because like there were so many people had the first microdosing event was in 2016 and there were 80 people. And the University of Leiden was there, and we took a microdose. And at first, we took some tests. Then we took a microdose, and then afterwards, we took also a little bit of tests. So the University of Leiden was conducting that, and so we saw there's a lot of people interested in. So, and then I thought, hey, if we create a website and a community, then we can map why people are doing this and what are the benefits and the pros and cons. Because my friend who we were talking about, we always took a high dose of psychedelics or mushrooms to cut off his cluster attack. But that was high dose. So I only knew in that days that a high dose was effective for cluster headaches. So I wanted to find out after he passed away, could microdosing have worked also for preventing cluster headaches? And now I know because we did a research project that a lot of people need a higher dose, like mini dosing. 1.5 grams every 5 days, so they also have a different protocol. So the Fadiman protocol, the Microdosing Institute protocol, is not efficient, but they also need to don't take too much because of the tolerance. So that's why I got into the website and my mission to find out if it is a cure for anything, because if it is it is a medicine for people with cluster headaches, actually, like LSD and magic mushrooms. So it's so strange that those illegal drugs who are non-toxic and they have researchers already have been proven that it's not addictive and that's non-toxic and you can't die from it physically. I find it's so strange that people with cluster headaches, it's called suicide headaches, can't access a medicine like that. So,
I was just listening to Dr. Fadiman talk about you guys, Microdosing Institute and cluster headaches on a podcast he was doing the other day. And which brings me to what just happened in Canada, where they approved, I believe, 4 or 5 terminal cancer patients the ability to use psilocybin legally, which we all should applaud, and is a huge step in us being able to treat our conditions with psilocybin. So things are moving along. Are there any other specific conditions, Jacobine, that you have seen with your clients and people within your community that this has helped with?
Yeah, well, I'm actually also thinking about the high doses. I'm so glad and so relieved that now, you know, it seems to have been taking a long time since MAPS started with their first research project and advocating in 86, that now finally there's so much more research being done for addictions. I actually just heard about Ben Sessa in the UK, who got he's getting his publication out in The Lancet about alcohol addiction, treating that with MDMA. So I think those things are all like finally, you know, groundbreaking. And it seems there's such a promise for psychedelics in general, for also for eating disorders, for addictions, for PTSD, of course, for depression with all kinds of backgrounds and origins. So there's so much potential. And it's interesting that clinical research is now focusing on the higher doses and not yet on microdoses, while those might actually be, you know, more accessible and probably less scary for a larger group of people. And as far as I know, but maybe Hein, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think there's actually any clinical research going on for cluster headaches with psychedelics. I think
there's going to be, we collaborate with the University of Maastricht with Kim Kuipers, and she's writing an online microdosing study for people with who are microdosing for the ADHD. But now they also work with Michael Lichti from Basel University in Switzerland, and they are now conducting a clinical study for people with ADHD with microdosing, and they are also doing a clinical study for people with cluster headaches, but then with the higher dosing. So that's what's happening now.
And Jacobine, you said something that I think is important, is I think that microdosing is something that comes across to the masses as something that's a little bit more manageable. I know for certain people that I've talked with, that large journey hero dose is maybe not something that they're ready for or ready to face. And the microdosing can be somewhat of an introduction. Obviously, I'm going to guess that the three of us have had plenty of experience with large dose journeys, and we know that there's real importance to those as well in the right set or setting. But I do think microdosing is something that can introduce a lot more people to psychedelics and show them the positive benefits. I know for me, I never would have thought eat less of this substance. You know, it was always how much could we eat and what crazy shit could we do. So again, I think it's important that we're bringing these ancient tools into really safe set and settings.
And actually even the science seems to have taken the same approach, because we both had a similar experience, like how could something in such a small dose still be effective? Like, isn't there a threshold that's you know, that we have to reach? And and I think science was approaching it in the same way, and just not believing, and still science is now in the stage with microdosing of actually proving that these small doses are actually effective. And we know that from some studies also done in Maastricht and in one or two other universities in the US, that it is actually quite hard for a lab doing psychology studies on people with very small doses, so 5 to 10 micrograms of LSD, and to prove in one session that those are effective, that those have an effect on, say, your creativity or your focus, or because it's like they put people in a lab, have them do tests on the computer, so they are completely, let's say, out of their normal lives. They are not tuned in with themselves. They are just in an isolated setting, being asked to do a certain task that is not a task that they would normally do in their life, that doesn't actually make sense to be doing. And out of those tasks, there's no difference. The microdose doesn't seem to make a difference. But when you put people in their natural setting in their daily life, they seem to have And we don't know if this is something like the natural, going more into your natural order, going more, being more present in the moment and therefore being more tuned in with whatever you are doing, or is it like your personal intention that you have, that you want to have like a productive day, or that you want to have, you know, meaningful relationships in that day, or that you want to be creative and really get into the flow with your work. That might also be a factor. We still don't know what are those factors, but then it seems that it is actually effective from day one. So just science seems to not have come up with the right kind of measurements of the effects, the immediate effects of microdosing. Yeah. And we actually hope that science will also focus more on long-term microdosing. So, you know, from 1 month to 2 months, and also long-term effects, 6 months or more, et cetera. Just because we don't really have any scientific data on that yet.
That's what our next project, we would like to do that project, that we have an online survey for the long-term benefits or pros and cons. So some people benefit from it and some people don't, but we really like to know. And the last study, the dosing finding study, the University of Maastricht did, they also noticed, and I discussed it with Kim Kuipers, who conducted it, that the clinical study, like Jacobino always said, if you are in a university and you're doing creative studies on a computer, that's not, you're missing the point with microdosing, because it's a whole holistic thing of factors that influence each other, which we can have a beneficial experience. And it's also the indirect effects that's starting to emerge after a few weeks also. So you have the direct effects and you have the indirect effects of microdosing, and that is so hard to measure actually, apart from anecdotal stories. So that's what she's going to build in also with her publication of that dosing finding study, that it's really hard to measure those kind of things. So that I take that dose and you are starting to get more creative or something. So it's not the case. They did find out that they, at one point, people got more focused. So that's why she thought, hey, that's an area we have to, we look for, that people who lack focus, like people with ADHD. Mm-hmm. So let's find out if it works for them. So I think it's best to do that online, but people do it in their natural habitat or something. So.
Well, yeah, that's interesting, because that's what a lot of people ask me, specifically ones that are trying to wean off of prescription medications that they've been on for 10 or 15 years, which is, how long am I going to have to microdose? How long does this last? Am I going to be microdosing for a year? Am I going to be microdosing for 2 years? If I stop taking this antidepressant, does that mean that I'm going to microdose every day for the rest of my life? And it's actually not what I'm finding. I'm finding the exact opposite, which is the longer people are microdosing, the less they need to microdose, because they're making changes within their life that sets their life up to not even need the microdose. I know for myself, when I started microdosing 2.5+ years ago, I was going through some hard times. I used it quite a bit. Now I'm at the point where the days and weeks are so good, I'm forgetting that I haven't taken it. So again, what's your guys, what are you seeing with longevity? Do you know people who, what are you seeing when they're taking it longer?
There are people, maybe some exceptions, who take it for a longer period of time, but we see this exactly the same. So people take it less. So that's, it's not a proof, of course, but it shows that it's non-addictive, because a lot of people after the Federman protocol or the Microdosing Institute protocol, after 2 months, they just do it more intuitive. Sometimes weeks, they just forget it, because they. But that again, it all depends on if you have if you have integrated your insights that you have, then you don't need a microdose anymore to integrate. Yeah, because you have integrated that and you have learned more inspirational patterns and more healthy patterns. So that's a good thing actually, that the people starting to take less microdosing.
I'm a strong believer also that you know, whatever practice that works for you, and for some people that is meditation, for other people that is regular exercise, you know, going outside, get your body moving, going to nature, breath work, really making use of the full 100% of your lungs, lung capacity, that, you know, and doing all those things on a regular basis, they are, those are the things that are really going to sustain you and your, you know, your natural balance, and make you more resilient also in times of, you know, crisis or anxiety or things we are currently experiencing in the world. So yeah, microdosing can be a really good starter, and then at some point it sort of balances out and you really decide for yourself what role you want to want microdosing to play in that life of yours. So, and I also find we have a funny example, somebody on our team who microdoses just once a week, so just on Mondays to get the week started, you know, in the right manner, and then it's just off it goes from there. So yeah.
And I think that's a great point, Jacobine, and that kind of brings us full circle on what we've been talking about, is I don't think that there's one right protocol for everyone. I don't think that there's one right dosage for everyone. Everybody's a little bit different. So it's about finding out what works for you and you specifically. Now, like you said, if you've done a month of the Fadiman protocol and you come up with your own protocol, that's called intuition. That's just you following your body and what your body needs. And I think that that's important. I also think connecting to a community is important. You guys have more than 4,000 people on your Facebook page. Can you tell us how we can find your Facebook page, how we can join your community? I know a lot of people on Burning Man have experience with large and small doses. So before we wrap up here, will you give yourself, tell us a little bit about where we can find the both of you?
Yeah. So and also our Facebook community, I think it's amazing. It's, people are so engaged, and there's so many individuals in there who really share what they know and what they've tried. And sometimes it's several people within their family of different ages and with different backgrounds who've been trying different protocols, and they're sharing all of that like in a really like enthusiastic way. And and so there's like first timers and avid microdosers really learning from each other. So we think it's amazing, especially if you don't have access to a coach or a therapist and you still want to have that guidance.
And that's what's great about your community and what you guys have done. And what I want to point out about microdosing.nl and the Microdosing Institute is that you guys created a website and a platform for all the civilian scientists out there who've been doing this to come and share their story. And then I'll go on that platform and I'll see new microdosers who don't have guidance or a coach. And all of a sudden they'll get just some incredible feedback and some incredible guidance. And so you guys are really creating a great resource. And I just want to thank you for that. I'm on that page daily, sometimes answering questions, sometimes asking questions. So everybody should definitely check that out. What are the websites where the Burning Man community can find out more about how to share their data and research with you guys?
Yeah, we have a Dutch website. We started off with a Dutch website called microdosing.nl. That's also the Facebook group name. But yeah, because now we're starting to get more questions in Europe, so we are now developing, and hopefully next month we are going online with the microdosinginstitute.com. Website. It's going to be an English website and French and German and Spanish. So that's where you can find us. Yeah. So yeah, you can. We have a newsletter and we have seminars and we have a YouTube channel, so called microdosing.nl. So you can find us.
I really ask anyone who's listening in the Burning Man community to check out that page, to follow it, and also to add your experience. And that's why I loved meeting Dr. Fadiman and sharing the data that I have with him, and why Dr. Fadiman connected myself with you guys, is because they're not allowing us to do clinical trials on this stuff, right? Even though the FDA has fast-tracked psilocybin twice, we're still not doing a bunch of trials on the benefits of microdosing. So you guys are really leading us, really helping us push it forward, that, hey, we are scientists. We are our own guinea pigs, and we've got a lot of really great research and data out there. So thank you guys for what you're doing.
We are all explorers, right? We are all explorers, and at some point somebody will be able to say we're an expert or somebody is an expert, but until there is enough scientific research, I think it's we're all explorers and we're all in this together.
Yeah,
learning from each other.
Yeah, that's great. We're all exploring, we're all figuring this out. And so going out there with research or data or information on their experiences with microdosing, please go down to microdosing.nl or follow them on Facebook and please share your information with them. Again, I really think that community is key when you're microdosing or you're doing any kind of healing type art. So if you're doing the microdosing on your own, these people can still get free information on your guys' website. Is that correct?
Yeah, yes, that's for sure. Yeah, the Facebook group is all about helping each other out and sharing experience, concerns. So if you're doing it on your own, you can perfectly find all the information. Our website is for free, but some people lack some tools or want more information or more personalized protocols and guidance or therapists. And then our coaching network comes in. But you can perfectly do it on your own, of course. I always say that the teacher is in the plant and in yourself. So yeah, you can perfectly do that yourself.
Yeah, I would like to add my personal recommendation, really, I know it doesn't resonate with everybody, but journaling. So really a free flowing stream of consciousness, just writing down all your thoughts, all your frustrations, everything you don't want in life any longer, write it all down. Then look what is actually behind this. Is this fear? Is this, where does this all come from? And what do you want? So, really journaling is a really good tool to sort of have no criticism, no judgment. It's a free tool that you can do it by yourself, but it gives you so much insight into your own patterns and your own thought behavior and what is actually there, what opportunities are there to start changing and transforming on a day-to-day basis.
It's the first thing we recommend when people are starting to microdose. Please keep a journal because, you have so much minimal cues and realizations during the day, and you tend to forget it, like dreams. If you have a dream journal, if you are more aware of writing it down, you start having more vivid dreams. And it's the same with during the day. If you microdose and you write down a word or a realization or hey, I feel more empathy towards my children, or I feel much more empathy towards my colleagues or something, just write it down. And a few days later, you see starting to emerge a pattern or something. And you really can learn from that. So yeah, that's a good thing to mention.
Journaling is key. And a lot of times when we're parents or adults, we forget to take time for ourselves and we forget to take time to look inward. And again, if you're not working with coaching or community, or even if you are, journaling is a really great way. Yeah. I know that when I'm working with people, sometimes they're not getting huge results in the first few days and they're expecting almost that large dose feeling. And then I ask them to read me some of their journal and they'll read their journal or they'll reflect on their day and then they'll be like, oh, wait a minute. Okay, I get it now. It's really little subtle changes. And so again, that's what that journal really helps, is it really helps you notice the little things that you might not notice in your normal fast-paced day-to-day life.
That's why the book of Ayelet Waldman is so nice, A Really Good Day. That's at the end of the day, that's the most important thing about microdosing, that you have a really good day, that you are positive and in the present moment and enjoying your life. So and journaling and setting the intention is also one thing we really have to emphasize. You have to set course during a microdose day. So you have to set an intention of how you want to feel that day and really make a connection to that infinite field of possibilities or whatever you want to call it. If you have that connection and you feel that connection, then you really, your brain needs a goal and you need a way to go somewhere. So So if you are setting the tension, is really important.
I believe that really helps, you know, with the neuroplasticity. So forming new pathways, you have to actually make clear for yourself and for the universe, what do I want that new pathway to look like? So how do I want to feel today? And if you are just focusing on, okay, I want to be less anxious, or I want less anxiety, or I want less of this, you're still focusing on your problem. And an intention is always a positive thing, something you're after. And that actually makes you believe. And we see that with people with ADHD, for example, if they really have the intention to work in a focused manner on the project that they love most, they really get that done, you know, while they normally have issues finishing any other projects, start a lot of things and nothing really gets done and nothing really moves forward. But if they have the intention to work on this one project, be in the flow, then they see, hey, I actually can get it done. And that shows them that that path is actually there for them to follow also the next time. So important and really nice to cover this for yourself. And
it's important what you mentioned, that stop smoking or quit smoking or I want to have less anxiety. That's not a goal on its own. That's a source of something you would like to have. So what do you gain if you stop smoking? You would gain more health. And what do you gain when you have more health? So if you, then you step up to your higher self, and that's the goal behind the goals, we call that. So start asking yourself, what do I gain if I have that goal?
It's a pretty fascinating subject, microdosing, and I know that we can talk for hours on all of it.